picture. I mean, de Kooning used to say he didn't want his pictures to be any, and they were a lot bigger than yours, but he said he didn't want them to be any bigger than a man with his arms spread out. And that was his way, his sort of Dutch way of keeping human scale. And I think you're like that too. I can't imagine you painting a giant painting.
No, I thought
can you,
I...
Gary? I can't. I
making this one larger. I know this painting.
This yeah, is the fair, owner of this painting, so he knows what he's talking about. I mean, do you like living with this painting? Is it? No, I don't see the arrow. Where's an arrow? Oh, God. But so I do think that when you're small, there's this whole, everything in the end, look, I mean, the same compositional problem presents itself, whether it's a big painting or a little painting. So you could, and on my paintings, I've talked about color today, we've talked about color and stuff, but my brain is always thinking composition. You know, if I put this here, how do I balance it? I mean, I'm not saying how do I balance it, but I am always doing that. So it's the color with the shape and the size. If I were to do it big or little, that same composition problem, if the proportions are the same, would present itself. But by making it little, you know, I feel the sweep of my arm in making a curve, for example, and I paint with both of my hands. I'm not ambidextrous, but there are certain moves I can only do with my left hand. I've never figured out why, but like I can only punch my ATM machine with my left hand. I can't do it with my right hand. I have no idea why. It's really weird. But anyway, it may be because my purse was always in my right hand and I... but there is something about the arcs and the curves, and also painting an oval is doable. I can't do Giotto's famous O. But I'm damn good with an oval. There, I got damn out without having to.
Do you ever use a really long brush?
No. I maybe could do a nice Giotto O with a circle with a long brush, but I know that that's a tool that would help. But I have found that the perfecting of the oval is very satisfying. I mean, a lot, and you mentioned the bulby forms. They are, yeah, I think, I mean, I don't need to be analyzed to know
that
they're
sexy. Talk a
little
bit about the goofiness. I forgot to ask you about that. But people are very interested in the comedy, the sort of light wit and the slightly goofy comic book forms.
Well, anything round is sort of goofy looking. I think breasts and testicles are goofy looking to me. I mean, they're also...
In the same way?
Well, in a funny interchangeable sort of way, they're dangling... And they're round, and they're cute.
This is degenerating.
but I think round things also are cute. Like babies are round. Baby things are round. And I think that round is cute as opposed to angular. So I think there's a cute aspect. But that said, when my daughter was little and wandering around my studio when I was painting, if she'd say, "Mommy, I see a bunny rabbit," I would quickly go and alter the painting so it didn't look like a rabbit. That's true. As soon as she'd say, "I think it looks like a bunny rabbit," I'd change it. But I do think that some of the fun comes from rounded forms. And I have joked that I see noses and profiles in my own paintings, but I don't think they are picturing them.
Yeah, you think of that as a profile?
Yeah, a bit of a nose and then the upper lip and then the chin. I see it a little, but I'm not illustrating.
I think one of the things that you do that's really, really interesting is that you modulate these different things. So you don't let one element, as you were saying, Gary, get out of proportion, really, so that the goofiness doesn't become wildly goofy, or the luminosity doesn't become wild. I mean, or the color really strange. It's just, it's all kind of nothing asserts itself to the point of tyranny, and so the painting can be looked at for.
Did
a
you
long...
write that? That sounds really good.
I'm just babbling. Anything else?
Well, it's always something I'm reading. And actually, Jane Austen titles appear in a whole lot of my paintings. And they're phrases from Jane Austen. Now, she did not do The Stubborn Blockhead. It came from a Ruth Rendell mystery that I was reading. But many people have asked me, is that your husband? The Stubborn Blockhead. Many people. So, and I have said, I leave it to you. But for whatever it's worth, the title of the show, I am eternally grateful to Mary for that, because we were thinking about titles to the show, and Mary said, Mary proposed Sense and Sensation. And I was in the other room, and Peter was in a room working. I said, Mary proposes Sense and Sensation. And Peter yelled out, that's how we communicate. We yell from room to room. It's a Fendrich tradition. My sisters know what I'm talking about. So he yelled out, perfect. And so, and actually I think he said brilliant. I mean, he thought it fit what my paintings were. And I think that it was such a wonderful title in the most flattering way of what I think I am striving to do. But many titles come from Jane Austen. They're phrases from Persuasion and Pride and Prejudice in particular. You might not recognize just two words. And also Karen Akers. I love her song, so a lot of... this is The Frame Around the Dog, and it's from a Karen Akers song. So it's very much, very colloquial. It's not what the paintings look like. Oh, no.
It's the blockhead.
No question, just a little pretty slang and phrases.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Like out of date.
I do. I forgot about that. I went through a long period of, in the early paintings in this show are that period of 30 slang. Like I named paintings like Cinnamon Toast and Lamb Pie and Cat's Cradle, or slang words that I just would pick up from jazz songs from the 30s and stuff. And Peter helped me, because Peter knows a lot about, he grew up in a with a dad who loved jazz, and Peter knows jazz, and I would say, give me some jazz words, because I learned what jazz I know, which is limited, from Peter, and he would give me good titles. So that was a period. I don't do it anymore, but so the titles are just stuff in my brain, not what they look like. One thing I pride myself in doing with the teaching is I really. I do try to introduce my students to some texts, to use word. I mean, book used to work, but now you have to say text. Books or short stories that they really don't encounter very much from other teachers, and they're wonderful. So, for example, I have all my students read Balzac's short story, The Unknown Masterpiece, in French, even if they can't read French. No, in English. And it's a fantastic story, if you know the story, because it's Balzac's story about a genius, Fraunhofer, but it's essentially the invention of abstraction by accident, before avant la lettre, before the fact. And the crisis of Fraunhofer in painting his way to try to make a perfect painting, and then painting past the perfect painting until he goes into complete wallowing in self-absorption, and he thinks he's painted the most beautiful perfect nude. And all the visitors come and look, and they can't see anything except the fragment of a foot that's left over from the nude that he painted multiple times, kind of like the de Kooning loved the story, yeah. I understood. Anyway, I'll give my students this to read. So, and it's my way of saying, you have to learn when to stop, because some of them will just, I have a couple students who have a tendency to just paint and paint, like I do, past the point where they, hello, new painting. So I have introduced them to some things that you can read that are helpful to your overall thinking about painters. So I don't direct them. They find their way to Judith Butler. I direct them to Alexis de Tocqueville, Democracy in America, and chapters on what happens to art in a democracy. And I think that comes out in my teaching. I was a pretty young artist. I had found out about Warhol. And a big moment for me was discovering Juan Gris. And a teacher in college did point Juan Gris. Very, very much just said, you might like this painter. And then another big moment for me was the Met show. By then, I'm what you would, I think of, I was had reached my mature phase as an artist, which I think I am in now. If I'm going to be there, I'm there now. Was the Stuart Davis show at the Met in early 90s, whenever, 91, 2, 3. And that show really kind of consolidated for me that I really did love this kind of art. Now, I had already been looking at a lot of it in I would say around the mid-80s, I was looking at it a whole lot. But I kind of found it on my own. I just think, as Pollock said this, that every artist invents the technique he needs, and I think every artist finds what he or she needs. You just plain find your way to it. And it takes time. That's the only thing, and that's the only one thing I worry about with young artists, is they're not given any time. They're supposed to, like, get in good, like, hip shows early, and we all admire the young artist who's hip right away, and it's too bad, because a lot of artists mature, need some time to mature, and so I think that's too bad. Because I certainly needed time to mature, and I think there are others like me. Well, there were two things that I learned from this process. One is, every artist in this room, take care of your work. Because when Mary said, I like this painting, I think it should be in the show, and then I went and retrieved it from deep hoarding storage. Some of my paintings had mildew and mold all over them. I mean, it was like, oh my God, what am I gonna do with this? And fortunately, I know this woman, who's a friend, and she taught me how to clean them. It's so gross, but it turns out that human spit has enzymes in it that cleans mildew off paintings, mildew and dirt. But, so that's one thing. And the second thing I learned was...
I would like a picture of that.
I know, it was so ridiculous, but it worked. But the second thing was, like, why did it take me so long to go from point to this to that? I just don't understand. When I look back on it, it seems like, well, you should have gotten there a little faster, but it took you 7 years. And I don't get it. I don't know. It's just something painters have to paint through. When you look back, it looks like, oh, of course put an oval in. You know, why not? That's what you're aiming for. Look at all these paintings with ovals. So why didn't you do that 10 years earlier? I don't know. It never dawned on me to one hot day in a studio, I just suddenly put an oval in. So that struck me, that painters just paint through this slow way to these things, and, like, just looks so slow in this age when people can whip things around on a computer, you know? Yeah, it's really not a mysterious process. I do a little drawing in the proportions of the painting, and I'm very good at copying proportions, so I can copy that little drawing using very thin paint as a line drawing onto the canvas. But perverse artist that I am, almost immediately I might change it a little bit. And then I begin with very thin. I paint in the traditional oil painting way, thin to thick, light to dark. And the most important thing is, if you're an oil painter, is you've got to remember fat over lean. That took me a while, and I had some craquelature in some early paintings before I learned about, you've got to know your structure of oil painting, because oil painting is oxidizing for a long time. And if you put a color without enough fat in it on top of an underlying color that's dried, you know, and then you put a color on top of that that doesn't have enough fat in it, you're going to get all this turmoil underneath. So that took like a decade to figure out. Hello, Ralph Meyer's Handbook to Oil Painting was sitting there the whole time, but that would have been too easy. But that's a process. My friend is here from Chicago. Her husband teaches artist materials. Of course, in the age of the 60s, 70s, you could skip courses like that. So I didn't learn that stuff from any teachers. It was all like, paint, and I'll see you in a couple hours. You know. And so that was my art education, you know? So I had to kind of learn this stuff. And so I have learned. I have learned how to build it correctly. And that took a while. And so they are built slowly. And one thing is, I stay light long, because it's very hard to change dark back into light. And I can't go, that big dark shape on the right, if you see the painting in the show, it looks black. It's not black. It's actually, I don't use black except to tint yellow to make a green. So I use it to make a hue. But I never use the pigment black for a hue. I just paint, it was red for a long time, and then I paint viridian green over it. And the viridian green, as a glaze over the red, produces black. So,
or a kind of mysterious black.
Not a different black.
It's not black.
So it's like, those things are things I learned. Because every painter is like half alchemist. You just learn by doing. And I think, in fact, Leonardo was an alchemist, partly. Judy, you're my expert on Leonardo. I don't know, but I think he did kind of do some alchemy, too. And so I learned stuff like that. Anyway, so I'm building from light to dark, thin to thick. and trying to do the fat over lean and not violate that. So the painting will have a shelf life beyond my life. And so they change. Like in a painting like this, I don't remember, but I did not have that design at the beginning. It could have altered tremendously. Those shapes that you see made probably began as much larger shapes that I broke up and then fused again back into larger shapes. So the end result is intuitive, not planned out. It's exactly that. Actually, a lot of the edges go right back to the ground of the canvas. But I pull back with each successive layer of paint. And I'm pulling back a little from the edge. So it starts to kind of get, because I love the way it looks. It's really simple. I just think it looks beautiful. And so I'm pulling back a little. And then what happens is the paint begins to drag differently. Once the layers are built up, the paint actually drags differently on the little bumps. And so then you start to get a different look along because of the way paint drags over it. So in the beginning, I might hit a painting that looks pretty good structurally, but it just doesn't have the tactile edges yet. So sigh, I have to keep painting. And that's unfortunate because I can't just keep painting the same thing, so I have to paint a new painting over it as it grows. So it's really bad if I reach a good painting too early, which I try not to do. So, one more question. I do work on a couple at a time, two or three, and the reason is practical. Oil paint takes some time to dry. If I just worked on one, I would have to sit around watching paint dry. So, and also, that's why some of the paintings, end up being kind of partners, because the palette is very similar. But I never work on more than two or three. But it is a practical matter. I only paint maybe 12, maybe in a big year, maybe 15 paintings. They take a long time to paint, and I would paint five if I were painting one at a time. So it's helpful to me. Well, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
How's it going?
Thank you.